are coming to you from Citi Field in the Big Apple, New York City, where this afternoon Comcast SportsNet presents White Sox baseball. It's Todd Frazier, Red Laurie, Jose Abreu in our Sox as they get set to butt heads with Terry Collins, New York Mets. Hi, everybody, and welcome. I'm Ken Harrelson with Steve Stone, and before we go any further, very happy Memorial Day to each and all out there. Make it a reflective and a loving one. But we're here coming out of Kansas City where we played the most unusual three-game series I can ever recall in my whole baseball career. We had our lead in every one of them late in the ballgame, too substantial, and we lost all three. But we're coming here today for this three-game set, and we're in a place where the Sox over the years have liked to be.
There's four teams that haven't played an interleague game, and the Sox put that to rest today, and they certainly enjoy playing interleague, and we'll take a look at why. Career 4-3 against the Mets head-to-head, 1-1 in this ballpark, and overall 191-152, the third best winning percentage in all of baseball. So entering interleague play, the Sox should have some sort of confidence that they're going to turn this thing around.
Well, today Robin's going to send a very fine southpaw out to that bump.
Jose Quintana, who hasn't won a game since May 8th, is going to the mound. Now, each and every time out, he throws the ball very well, and today should be no exception. He leads the American League in ERA. He's got to move the ball in and out. He also does a better job of elevating that fastball than probably anybody in the league, and so that will hold him in good stead. And he's going to have to be, because Matt Harvey normally is good, although this year they can't figure out why that ERA is above 6. He's 3-7. They speculate maybe the innings last year. Whatever it's been, he can't find the answer yet, even after reviewing some tape. So we'll have to see how it plays out today, and hopefully the offense will come to play for the Sox today.
Well, Jose is going to have to use all four quadrants because these Mets can hit the long ball.
They can take the ball out of the park with regularity, and we'll take a look at some of the sluggers. Cespedes, one of those guys. Conforto, another one of those guys. They lead the major leagues with 71 home runs this year. And they've moved the fences in at this ballpark. And that means that their sluggers are even better. We're not going to see Granderson for the time being. But as you can see, Frazier, Cespedes, Cano, and Prumbo all lead baseball with 15 home runs. Jose's only given up one home run all year long. And if he keeps the ball in the park with the struggles that Harvey has had, Sox should be in good shape.
All right, well, the stars and stripes and baseball on this day of remembrance as we honor those who have fallen. So sit back, relax, and strap it down. White Sox baseball coming your way.
Baseball on CSN Chicago is brought to you in part by Toyota. Discover more in a Toyota. Visit buyatoyota.com or your local Toyota dealer today. Let's go places. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Illinois. Through it all, Audi, truth in engineering. And by Xfinity. Xfinity X1 will change the way you experience TV.
Welcome back to Citi Field in New York. And you're looking at the USS Intrepid aircraft carrier at the Air and Space Museum on the west side of Manhattan, right in New York City. And there you look at Citi Field, and a lot of folks in attendance here today. The Mets come in second place, a game in back of Washington. Sox come in third place, a game in back of Kansas City, a half game in back of Cleveland. And let's take a look at how Robin's going to line him up against Matt Harvey. Adam Eaton leading it off, and Jose Abreu in the two spot. Melky Cabrera hitting third with Todd Frazier. Always hit well at this ballpark, hitting cleanup. Then J.B. Shuck in the lineup. As Tommy Cainley was sent down, Shuck was brought back up. Brett Laurie at second, Jimmy Rollins at short, Alex Avila behind the plate, and Jose Quintana will grab a bat and hit ninth. The defense and how they'll line up behind the struggling Matt Harvey. It's Cespedes, Lagares, and Diaz in the outfield with Kelly, Cabrera, Walker, and Flores in the infield. Rene Rivera gets a nod behind the plate, and our Lexus Pursuing Perfection starting pitcher is Matt Harvey. You look at those numbers, you just have to blink. This is a guy that was among the best in baseball not too long ago. In fact, into postseason play last year. This year, a completely different story. The umpires for the game this afternoon, Carlos Torres, Sam Holbrook at first, Jerry Davis, the crew chief at second, Rob Drake at third. And something to watch today, the Mets have some history with this umpiring crew. The last time they saw them, there was a number of different arguments, and there's no doubt that the Mets have remembered it. Umpires normally have fairly short memories, so hopefully there is no carryover today, but that one is looming in the background, and see if it unfolds here this afternoon. So they've thrown the ball around the infield, and that means that we're ready to start the first interleague play game of the year, and it's time for me to turn it over to my play-by-play partner, Ken Harrelson.
All right, Steve, thank you. And once again, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to White Sox Baseball right here on Comcast Sportsnet. And the first pitch of the ball game to Adam Eaton. He's taken for a strike. And before we show you our picks to click, you at home select yours. Adam comes in at 288, three homers, 16 knocked in. And we have seen Matt Harvey in this ballpark before. As you saw in those stats, we played two games here. We won one and lost one. And the one we lost, it was Matt Harvey. And that ball hit into left center field. And in that ball game, that was the best stuff we saw that season, and we had no chance.
Now, Matt Harvey had an enchanted game, and he's had a career similar to that. Last year, although it was a comeback year from his surgery, he was 13-8. Year before that, 9-5. So he's used to being the top dog, and that hasn't been the case this year.
Here's Abreu. Yeah, that was Nintendo stuff that he had that day against us. It was similar to the stuff that 2 years ago that Jake Arrieta had against us.
It was that dominating a game.
Yeah. And here at Citi Field, 330 down the right field line, 335 down the left field line, 358 in left center, 380 in deep right center, and 408 dead away center.
Harvey's had some problems keeping the ball in the ballpark. Last time out, he gave up three home runs, and that tied a career high.
Walker's got him. Two down. So with two out, let's check out our picks to click. Jim Angio, Mike Leary, Dave Ross, the mayor, Mean Joe Group, they're going to go with Alex Avila. See who's going to go with Jimmy Rollins. And for all our fallen heroes and our great women and men around the world in the service of our country, We thank you. We're going to go with J.B. Shuck. Here's Melky at 281, four homers, 24 knocked in. And for your information, FYI, Austin Jackson will not be available today.
And they're certainly hoping that he avoids the disabled list.
And that's the 1-2-3 inning. After half inning players, our guys nothing, and their guys, well, they're coming to bat.
For the game this afternoon, it's Lagares leading it off. Then our old friend is Drubal Cabrera with Yoenis Cespedes, who is hitting the daylights out of the ball. Then it's Walker, Flores, Diaz, Rivera, Kelly, and Matt Harvey rounding it out. And the defense and how they'll line up behind Jose Quintana. Melky Cabrera, J.B. Shuck in center with Adam Eaton in right. Then it's Frazier, Rollins, Laurie, and Abreu in the infield. Alex Avila gets a nod behind the plate, and our Lexus pursuing perfection starting pitcher is Jose Quintana, looking for his sixth win of the year. A league-leading 2.22 ERA, and he's given up just one home run. That will be put to the test against his slugging bunch.
So here's Lagares, the center fielder, hitting at 293, a couple of homers, and six knocked in. Strange look to this Met lineup, as you and I were going over prior to the game. After you get through the first four hitters, it's absolutely the worst numbers I have ever seen from the fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, and ninth batters in a lineup, major league lineup.
I think that's explained, number one, with a left-hander on the mound. Granderson gets the day off. Conforto is not playing, and Conforto is a terrific player. David Wright is hurt at third base, and speculation is that he's going to have to go on the disabled list. They will decide tomorrow. They've traded for James Loney, and he could be inserted in the lineup.
Well, the reason I brought it up is because we have to be catching a break in that respect.
There's no doubt.
Okay. I mean, they're the worst five consecutive numbers I have ever seen in my career in a major league lineup. Now, we caught a break in Kansas City. They didn't have Gordon. They didn't have Moustakas.
And Perez left.
And there is a broken bat, one out. And Perez left in the middle of the second game.
Yep.
Well, he didn't play the third, and we still, as I said in the opening, that is the strangest, weirdest series I have ever seen in my major league, or not major, minor league and or major league career in a three-game series.
We went through a streak on this same ball club with the same guys in the bullpen where the team was the only undefeated team in the major leagues when having the lead after six innings. It was something like 18-0, maybe 19-0. That's why it's so surprising, taking the lead, a substantial lead in a few of those games, but a lead in all three, and not coming away with any wins.
Well, I got text, as I'm sure you did. I got, I don't know, 60 or 70 texts. What's wrong with our socks? What's wrong with our socks? And I'm going to tell you, in my opinion, what's wrong? And it's certainly not an excuse. I don't give excuses. It's a fact. As that ball hit high in the right center field, drifting back to shut on the top. And Cabrera's retired for out number two. First of all, it's the worst schedule I've ever seen for April. And it's a tough schedule for May. So you put those 2 months combined. We had one off day in April. We had three in May. Now, that is going to take its toll. And where the ugly head is going to rear up is in the bullpen. Because these guys, with no off days, they're having to get up more often than other teams. And that's where it's going to show. And that's where it has shown.
You figure this bullpen is going to have to roll around to a semblance of what they were the first 5 weeks of the season. They were absolutely unhittable, and they've been very hittable the last 3 weeks.
Well, you can't carry, you were a pitcher. You can't carry that kind of adrenaline for 2 months. I mean, you just can't do it, especially, you know, in my time frame when I played, when you had streaks like that, every club is going to go through three or four bad streaks in a season. But when you have a streak like of those consecutive days played like we've had for 2 months, it's going to show itself in the bullpen, whereas when I played, it was going to show itself in the starters, because the starters were going to go out there and go 7, 8, or 9. And the one great saving grace we had is that Chris Sale had three complete games.
Yeah.
That really helped that bullpen out, but not enough to where they still weren't tired.
There's a look at Robin as he's going to look for some offense, but first he wants to retire Cespedes. Quintana has really struggled with him.
Cespedes, one of three guys tied for the major league lead, as Mike Leary showed you earlier, 15 home runs.
He's faced Quintana 15 at bats. He's hit 600 with four home runs.
Yeah, he's, again, you got to pick out the guy you don't want to beat you, and it's certainly him. In Kansas City, it was Hosmer, and we let him beat us. But Quintana, if it's a close ball game, cannot let this man at the plate beat him. 9 for 15, four homers, and he's knocked in 10. He gone. 1-2-3 inning after one, no score.
And to look forward to Miller time later in the game, brought to you by Miller Lite.
Frazier, Shuck, and Laurie.
Matt Harvey's given up 8 home runs this year and now 54 innings of work. Most unusual for him.
And here's our guy, one of those three tied for the major league lead in home runs with 15.
What we've seen so far from Harvey is whatever the difficulties are, it's not affecting the velocity of his fastball. We've seen 97 in the first inning.
That's into center field. Lagares makes a catch. And Sox fans, we want to hear from you throughout the game. So use the hashtag White Sox Talk on Twitter and be sure to follow at CSN White Sox all season long for the latest news on your favorite team.
Harvey has opted a couple of times. Instead of side sessions in the bullpen, he's opted for simulated games twice. He just can't get the feeling. Now they went over a lot of tape and they think they picked something up. If that's the case, Harvey's going to fit right in with what has been an overwhelming starting rotation.
Shuck was hitting 299, a couple homers, 17 knocked in at Charlotte. Well, it's been my experience in all the years I've been in this game that when guys who had good stuff go down, miss a whole season, and come back, there's a three hopper and two down. In watching these guys, usually it's not the fastball that gives them the problem, it's the breaking stuff.
Well, it's confidence that. Yeah. Your elbow is not going to give you any more problems, and the most strain you can put on it is a hard breaking ball. So could very well be that. And one of the things I've always thought with Matt Harvey when I was looking at the numbers from afar and instead of watching him up close, he's probably never struggled in his career. So he doesn't know what it's like to go through a terrible period and come out the other end. And right now he's throwing all fastballs. And normally when you see a pitcher either can't or won't throw a lot of off-speed stuff or breaking balls, you just look for the express, more likely you're going to get it.
Well, one of the reasons too, in talking with pitchers, they have a tendency after they missed the season or had some surgery or had some problems with their elbow or shoulder through a hard throwers. With their breaking stuff, they have a tendency to get out there too far. Rather than shorten it up a little bit and give it on a chance to get on top. He's crisp. There's no question about that with that heater.
No, it's in fastball after fastball.
Nice foul back.
We'll take a look at perhaps the fatigue setting in. First time through the order. 241. Second time through the order, 301. And if he's around for the third time, it's been disastrous. Over 500 the third time through the order.
Well, that tells me as a hitter that he's not getting his breaking stuff over. It's just that simple. That's just fouled.
That was the first hard breaking ball he threw, and it was a slider.
Yeah, when those numbers with an arm like that go up, second time around, third time around, he is basically a one-pitch pitcher.
Even Eddie, how good the stuff used to be. In his first 75 games, only Dwight Gooden had more strikeouts in the history of the Mets. Dwight Gooden 1, Matt Harvey 2. That includes Pedro Martinez.
Well, as good as stuff as Matt Harvey has, I don't know if his stuff is as good as Dwight Gooden's. Dwight Gooden has some of the greatest stuff for a young pitcher I have ever seen.
Well, he had a nose-to-toes curveball, and it was, I believe, and I'm just guessing, I think it was 85. It was 24-4. I mean, just remarkable stuff. It was otherworldly.
Just got a piece. Well, I did a game for one of the networks here on television, and Davey Johnson was managing the Mets. Davey and I are good friends. Before the game, we were talking. He said, "Hawk, you're going to see something that you've never seen before." I said, "What's that?" He said, "You're going to see the best right-handed stuff you've ever seen." Sure enough, they were playing the Phillies. And I forget who I was doing the game with. I think he had like 16 or 17 strikeouts, and he was 102-0 on every hitter. I mean, it was just an exhibition.
He couldn't hold base runners close, but it didn't matter because he had no intention of ever giving up a hit after he got a base runner.
Tom Seaver the same way. Yeah, there's another. And for all our youngsters out there, Tom Seaver, a lot of people don't realize, is one of the greatest pitchers to ever toe the slab.
And there is the 41 of Tom Terrific, Hall of Famer, over 300 wins, and could throw the ball hard and down with anybody that's ever pitched.
That got him. Got him good.
Rene Rivera is saying that he swung, and apparently Carlos Torres agrees with him.
Get out there, Robin. He's liable to get thrown out. Meanwhile, it's going to stand, and that'll retire the side.
Insider all season long on csnchicago.com, presented by The Great Escape. It's pools, patio furniture, hot tubs, and more. Escape your everyday. Shop The Great Escape. And take a look. It appears that he's actually swung the bat after he was hit. So right here, he gets hit, and then the bat comes through. But Carlos Torres said that he did indeed swing it. A painful way to strike out.
And if he didn't hit him, that's one of the best acts I've seen in a long time. Of course, he's got the energy to do it. He jumps straight up in the air. Walker, switch hitter. One of three in this lineup.
Used to be with Walker that you didn't have to worry about him at all from the right side. That hasn't been the case lately. You see the numbers, and they're very good.
Last year at Pittsburgh. He had 269, 16 homers, and drove in 71. But the 71, it was not how many, it was when. He drove in some huge, huge runs last year for the Pirates.
And again, mostly doing it left-handed. This year, right-handed hitting .324 with four of his 11 home runs. In many less at-bats. In fact, only 37 at-bats, four home runs.
It's not unusual for a switch hitter who is a right-handed guy to be a better hitter right-handed but have more power left-handed.
And what do you think? Normally it's probably, what, 65-35, the more at-bats from the left side than the right?
Yeah. Yeah, somewhere in that area. Full count. Put a good pass on that one. Had a good pitch to hit just underneath it.
Walker spent his entire career with the Pirates. He made it to the major leagues in 2009. Had some pretty big years. 2010, he hit .296. Home run high, 23.
He gone.
Second strikeout, the Honda pitch tracks will show you that it's the outer third. And he threw it right by him.
So here's Wilmer Flores. Hitting at 170, a homer, he's driven in two. Last year, Wilmer hit .263, 16 homers, and drove in 59.
You might remember he was the guy that was actually crying when he was told he was being traded from the New York Mets. But Carlos Gomez didn't pass his physical. Flores came back. He's a shortstop by trade, but there were some problems.
Watch out.
The problems is he's not an overwhelmingly large fellow. But size 14 shoes make it a little more difficult to get that great range at short. So they've been playing him at third. They've been playing some at first. Lucas Duda, their longtime first baseman, is injured and out. And Flores getting his opportunity for a few at-bats.
Outfield slightly to the right, gap out there in left center.
And if the Mets do activate James Loney, what they're going to get is much improved defense at first base, as well as a steady contact hitter. They realize they're not going to be looking for power from Loney, but he will help defensively.
He's a tough out.
He is that.
Two down, three straight punch outs.
We talked about elevating that fastball when you get ahead. Nobody does it better than Jose. There's a few that do it as well. But as you can see, up and out of the zone, it looks inviting. You absolutely cannot catch up to it up there.
This is one of those fun parks to do a game in because of the acoustics. Makes that fastball sound like it's 100 miles an hour.
It certainly does. I mean, you can hear it into Avila's glove. It sounds like an explosion.
First pitch strike to Diaz, hitting at 196, the homer, one RBI.
Alejandro will foul more pitches off his body than maybe any other hitter in the major leagues.
I think certainly more than anybody I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And one thing about it, everybody, except, of course, when we were playing him, pulls for him because he's such a wonderful young man.
Well, normally, Diaz is not going to get any play either because when Conforto and Granderson are in the lineup along with Cespedes, that's an everyday outfield, and most of the extra outfielders have to pinch hit or get very limited duty.
Strikes out the side. That's four in a row, and we're into the third with no score. Tomorrow night watches Jose Abreu and our Sox take on these Mets right here in the Big Apple. Game two of this three-game series. Coverage begins with the first pitch at 6 p.m. on CSN Chicago.
Matt Harvey has used 24 pitches to get out of the first two innings. Only six of them balls, so he's getting the ball over the plate. And except for one or two pitches possibly, he's thrown all fastballs. And here's a guy who's hurt him in the past.
Rollins, 5 for 19 with a couple of homers lifetime off. Harvey.
It's really not only Matt Harvey. He's always done well against the Mets. Obviously, growing up and playing in the Philly organization for so many years, you run into the Mets quite a bit.
Well, it could be 0-2, but it's not as 1-1.
Both pitches almost identical.
Yeah. Sounded like a broken bat off the end, towards the end, and one out. Here's Alex. Avila at 203. No homers. He's driven in two. Game tomorrow night. Game two, it'll be Lutos against Steven Matz, big left-hander. There's first pitch strike at 95 right there. Well, if you're watching him, and you got a great uniform and you're watching Harvey, and you go to that plate, you got to be looking first ball, fastball.
Well, you're getting it most each and every time. And it's usually right down the middle.
He has not shown our hitters that he can get a breaking ball over. The only difference is if you're 0-1 rather than getting after that first pitch fastball, your strike zone becomes a little bigger.
Well, Harvey and Dan Worthen, the pitching coach, went over a lot of tape on just exactly what he was doing. They think they picked up a mechanical flaw. If that's the case, and the guy we're seeing here today and that stuff he's throwing, that and a 6-point ERA don't go hand in hand.
That's part of the zone.
Two down.
Third strikeout, and he takes a little something off. Rivera wants it outside, and he pretty much fills up the glove. Rivera, although it doesn't hit very well, he's a very good catch it, call it, block it, and throw it guy, and that's one of the reasons why he sees some backup action.
Quintana takes first pitch strike. That's off the plate.
Well, at 0 for 22, he's good.
Now, feel as you would suspect, short around to the right. Up nine down for Matt Harvey.
Beer night on Tuesday, June 28th. This year's event is going to be located in the patio area. The $45 ticket price includes access to the tasting room from 5:40 to 7:30. Complimentary food in the patio and an outfield reserve game ticket. To purchase, visit whitesox.com/specialty.
Rivera, Kelly, and Harvey. Face Quintana. Jose has struck out the last four he's seen. Rivera hitting at 120, a homer. He's driven in four. There was a strike and didn't get it. And you can cancel the post game, Joe. Broken bat, shattered.
Well, that bat went back to the bricks in a hurry, and he was left with just the handle. So six in a row now by the boards as the light hitting catcher eases it into center field.
That'll bring up Ty Kelly as he is 0 for 8 since being called up. He's a 275 minor league career hitter. And another switch hitter. Three of them, as I mentioned, in this lineup. You're starting to see a trend for teams favoring switch hitters.
Especially those who have a lot of versatility and can play other positions. Kelly's not really going to be the answer at third base if, in fact, they have to disable David Wright. And taking a cortisone injection in his neck after dealing with spinal stenosis the last few years, very difficult on the star third baseman. This year he hit seven home runs but only drove in 14, was having issues a lot of the year.
Well, he's the face of this franchise. What a player. Yep. What a player, David Wright.
Always magnificent at third base, and I think because of the back problems, the four errors in 37 games is most un-Wright-like.
Three and one. Jose, as a rule, normally has trouble from the stretch. Hit him on the fist, pops him up. Back, back, back.
Sox fans, join us as our Sox take on the Washington Nationals on Thursday, June 9th. That's at 7:10, and the first 10,000 fans will receive a free Todd Frazier t-shirt presented by the Village of Bedford Park. Bring your business home to Bedford Park and win big. Purchase your tickets today by visiting whitesox.com or calling 866-SOX-GAME.
Here's Matt Harvey. He's been to the plate 12 times. He has two hits. One of them a double. Short lead, static lead by Rivera.
Well, Jose didn't think about it.
No, he didn't.
If he would have, he'd have noticed Harvey didn't run. All you got to do is let the ball drop, and you've got yourself a pretty easy double play. Take a look at Harvey. He pops it up, but he stands there and without running.
I think probably Jose's pretty sharp on those things. I think probably what he's was a spin. And if he lets it drop, his lob will spin out of bounds. But outside of that, it looked like certainly nobody does that hardly anymore.
No.
Nobody. Nope. And I know you did, and I know we did in spring training, worked on that all spring long.
And in fact, the club still works on it. Every homestand, this club is out there bunting. But there's a big difference. They're not bunting against a guy throwing like the guys throw in the game. So it makes it a little more difficult.
That's popped up right side, Jose. You got the bead. the ball. And that'll retire the side. We're into the fourth, scoreless.
By T-Mobile. Bartolo Colon has been magnificent. There you see the record, 157 losses only, 222 wins, an ERA below four, a lot of starts, over 3,000 innings. And Bartolo Colon also can swing the bat, and maybe later in the show you'll get a chance to see that.
Well, there's another first ball fastball right there. I mean, there's no guesswork with Harvey so far, unless he changes.
Well, here's the second time through the lineup. That means that instead of that 241, and he was perfect through three, the batting average jumps to over 300 the second time through.
It was a close pitch. Harvey didn't get it. 2-1. You got to remember, a guy's throwing 97 and 98, and you're looking for it. To your eye, it's really not 97 and 98 on first pitch. But if you get 0-1, it 97, 98 is more like 100. Took a lot off of it.
We talked about the Bartolo Colon home run. Now, he has not perfected that home run trot. As you would expect. That was in San Diego, and he can't even believe it. Took him a while to get around the bases.
Bartolo, one of my all-time favorite Sox.
What's most amazing about him, he uses in the neighborhood of 90% fastballs. And at his age, that's remarkable.
Well, he can work the ball better than anybody in the game.
Can do that.
When he was with us in his last year, well, in 2003, he was 15-13 with a 387. And the Sox really tried hard to re-sign him and had, for the most part, a deal made for a lot of money. And all of a sudden, the Angels came in at the last moment, offered him another year at more money. And you couldn't blame him for, you know, not turning it down.
That wasn't the only time the Angels did that, I believe, in the Torrey Hunter
they
situation.
They did the same thing with Torrey.
Similar thing.
Kenny went after Torrey Hunter hard. Had a deal made, and then the Angels came in the last day and just overwhelmed him with money. And another year. But I think probably of all the possible free agents that the Sox have had pitching-wise, they tried to get, say, Cologne more than any other one.
When you're a great teammate and you have some talent, that's a tough combination to pass up. It'll be a fastball in. Let's see if he can handle it. Well, that gives you an idea that Harvey is not hitting all of his spots, because Rivera wanted it in, called for it in, and Harvey threw it high and away.
Six strikeouts now for Harvey.
When you consider in the last two starts previous to this, he had fanned a total of three guys, you can see that perhaps staying on top of the baseball, which is what they saw as they viewed the tapes, changing his hand and finger position on top of the ball certainly has worked for him.
Bartolo, in his year with us, had nine complete games, which led the league. And he used to come in when we'd be going a little bad and the bullpen was overworked. He'd come over and he said, "Honk." He couldn't say "Hawk." He said, "Honk." I go nine today. Meanwhile, he has retired 12 in a row. As the White Sox take on the Toronto Blue Jays on Saturday, June 25th at 1:10. First 20,000 fans will receive a White Sox beach towel presented by Shark Week. That starts June 26th on Discovery. Purchase your tickets today by visiting WhiteSox.com or calling 866-SOX-GAME. As Drubal Cabrera went out deep to just right of center. His first trip.
He's enjoying a resurgence. Cabrera came over and they thought, well, perhaps this was the end of it. He was fading. But he certainly picked it up here.
They've made some good decisions in the past couple of years.
He hit a home run against Clayton Kershaw, something that not too many people are able to do. And Cabrera, been around a long time and he's been very good for a while.
0-2 the count to the 30-year-old switch hitter. Last year at Tampa Bay, he hit 265, 15 homers, and drove in 58.
Field of Sam Holbrook, he said he didn't swing, and we'll look at it from the side. It looked like he could have rung him up, but.
Yep, he could have.
He got the break.
Easily. Two and two. Baseball, you make your own breaks. When you're going bad, like obviously we've been going bad, you don't get any breaks from an umpire either. When you're going good, you do. That Kansas City series, that first game was awful. Yeah, he did that time. You can't keep him away from that one. He gone.
This whole ball game has been strikeout city on both sides of the equation, but Jose had fanned four in a row at one point. He's throwing good solid fastballs both sides of the plate, elevating it when he has to, and continues to elevate it. So that time it was a breaking ball down as Drubal Cabrera could not check his swing, and that is strikeout number five.
It's a lot easier to cover in and out than it is up and down. As a hitter. In 1980, what were you throwing? Fastball.
Well, on today's gun, it would be the average fastball be 90 miles an hour on the gun they use today.
Yeah.
They use a little bit hotter gun these days, and it's about 5 miles an hour difference. I think they want to see the guys who throw it well hit triple digits or high 90s, and that's a big difference. But it was an average fastball. I just had to artificially make it move by cutting it and by holding it off center and doing a lot of different things.
My point is that from a hitter standpoint, now here's Matt Harvey throwing 96, 97, but he's throwing all first pitch strike fastballs. He's had 12 hitters. He's thrown 8 first pitch strikes, but he's thrown 12 fastballs first pitch. I'd rather hit against Matt Harvey with that 97, you with that 90. Because I'm not going to get that 90-mile-an-hour fastball down the middle. As there is a base hit by Cespedes, who just his own Quintana.
Yeah, that's the one guy you really have to worry about in this lineup. And fortunately, he kept it in the ballpark. So we'll take another look at it. And that time he went upstairs. This was actually a pretty decent pitch, but you see Cespedes get up on top of it, hit it right on the nose, and he's at first base.
Well, the point I'm making with your 90-mile-an-hour fastball, if you throw it, it's probably going to be in off the plate, or it's going to be either outside corner out, one of the two. You're not going to mess around with the middle of that plate with your 90.
I also don't want you to hit it. I want you to hit either my slider or my curveball. That's what I want you to hit. I'm going to show you the fastball just for effect. Walker is grounded into three double plays, and surprisingly, they've all been from the left side.
He was a strikeout victim, swinging on a fastball. This is a blue plate special, should be for an umpire.
Well, you get two pitchers with very good control. I mean, they don't miss very much at all.
That could have gone either way. Of course, it's going to go the Mets way here in New York. And Avila's saying something to him.
The Mets are not a running ball club. Cespedes just one out of two in stolen bases. The Mets, 10 steals. They've been caught 8 times. So speed is not even a factor with this team.
Well, you don't want Cespedes running.
Nope.
You don't want your big gun running and stealing bases.
He's got an interesting contract because they're paying him right around $23 million this year. But it's a 3-year contract with a 1-year opt out, meaning that regardless of what kind of a year he has, if he decides that he wants to opt out, go someplace else for more money, and he's got 2 years left at 27 a year after this year. Says he loves it in New York. We'll see how much he loves it when he can be a free agent if he turns it down and stays here.
Well, there was a lot of speculation that the Mets were not going to sign him. I told a couple of friends of mine, I said, I don't think there's any question that the Mets are not going to sign him. They will re-sign him.
But with what they had coming in and most of their power, an iffy David Wright at third and most of their other guys who swung the bat from the left side, Cespedes just balances out this lineup. He's got a great arm also, although he's not a great outfielder, but he can throw you out.
The one out, two on. First walk issue in this game.
We'd like to welcome all of our viewers watching on Wide Open West Cable in Chicago. The first opportunity in the ball game for either side to break through.
Wilmer Flores struck out his first trip. Again, a very happy Memorial Day to each and all. Make it a reflective and a loving one. And a safe one. Count evens and one. Two and one. Back and forth. That boy. And that'll end the inning. We enter the fifth, still scoreless. Davey Shuck, Brett Laurie.
And the fleet's in on this Memorial Day.
Now the first pitch fastball strike. And had him off balance. Out in front. Then the count 0-2.
Harvey throwing exactly like Danny Duffy. Duffy had his perfect game through five and a third. We're running into a buzzsaw.
Tied now 0-2, first time went out to center field. Here's Shuck. He grounded to second. His first trip.
51 pitches so far from Matt Harvey. Only 13 out of the strike zone. So he's found his command. Even when he was getting shellacked, he still didn't walk a whole lot of hitters.
That's off the plate. And one to count. There's a shot, and you can cancel the post game show. Our first base runner.
Harvey fell behind. He hasn't done that too often, and takes a little something off his fastball. That wasn't his best at 97. That was 93. Had most of the plate. And J.B. Shuck, welcome back.
So here's Laurie. Struck out his first trip. You know, we had, if you've been with us all the way, we were talking about, in my opinion, why our club had been in the funk. And it rears this ugly head when you had the schedule we have, and it rears this ugly head in the bullpen. In April, our bullpen was best in the big leagues, 4-0, with a 1.69 ERA. Now, Sox bullpen, listen to these numbers. Has suffered three losses and allowed 18 earned runs on 24 hits and 12 walks in the last seven games. And that is, we'll tell you, that's a tired bullpen, because you don't go from being the best in April to the worst in May unless you're tired. Well, you don't have any off days and your starters aren't completing games, and you're up almost virtually every day or every other day. Over the course of 2 months, it's going to get to you.
Here's a look at Don Cooper sitting next to Herm Schneider. Herm on his left.
One and two the count for Brett. J.B. Shuck could do, and that'll retire the side. We're halfway home, still no score. scoreless ball game. Only three hits in this game. We have one, they have two. But what a double play turn by Flores. What's this?
Time now for our Xfinity High Speed Action replay, and it's a rocket. Wilmer Flores able to grab it, and the rest is easy, and nothing J.B. Shuck could have done. That's just a horrible position for a base runner, and 100% of the time you're going to get doubled off.
Here's Diaz. Yeah, that is a 100 out of 100 percent.
Because you're going to be taken off, and that first baseman is usually, he doesn't have enough time to be anyplace else but between you and the bag.
Diaz into center field. That's a can of corn for sure.
On Friday, June 10th, come see the White Sox take on the Kansas City Royals at 7:10. All fans are invited to stay for a spectacular post-game fireworks show presented by Magellan Corporation. Purchase tickets today by visiting WhiteSox.com or calling 866-SOX-GAME.
So here's Rivera. Renee had their first hit, a exploding bat soft single in the left field. Takes first pitch strike. Nice crowd. Mets averaging almost 35,000 a game, 34,964. And the count 0-2.
Rivera started his career at 17. He came to the United States from Puerto Rico as the Seattle Mariners' second round pick way back in 2001.
Two and two.
When they originally built this ballpark, it was absolutely a pitcher's park. But they moved the fences in. You can see them a little bit there at the 358 mark. It was a lot tougher to hit it out originally, 335 down the line, and then it moves to 358 in the power alley, which is not a long way.
Well, offense puts fannies in seats, but defense wins championships.
And the Mets have had, in the course of their history, just some spectacular pitchers come through their system. And they've developed some pretty good ones, as well as making a good trade or two.
Well, they're the ones that started the five-man rotation back in 1969. Yeah. Softly. They won the World Series, and after that, people started saying, maybe we ought to give that a shot. That's ergo the five-man rotation.
Well, they had R.A. Dickey, and he had won a Cy Young Award, but they figured that it was time to try to get a little younger. So they decided they needed this young kid who threw hard in the minor leagues, wasn't highly regarded at that point. Noah Syndergaard. That trade worked very well, as Dickey has had his moments certainly with Toronto, but Syndergaard, when he's not throwing at Chase Utley, usually stays in games for a long time.
Yeah, I didn't see that. There's a bullet back through the middle by Kelly. I believe that's his first major league hit.
And that it is, so he will retrieve the baseball. And there it is. Line drive back through the middle, so he didn't get a cheapie.
So here's Harvey. He tried to bunt his first trip, popped up to Abreu. What a thrill for a youngster.
You remember who you got your first hit off of?
Yeah, Jim Cott.
700-foot home run?
No, that came in about the seventh or eighth inning.
So your first hit was luck.
Single right back through the middle, just like time. And then Kitty left the game, and they brought in a left-handed reliever named Bill Plice, Shorty Plice. He hung me a slider, and I hit it about 440 over that left center field fence.
Old Shorty Plice.
Yep.
Well, I'm still waiting for that first home run. I think it's just right around the corner. But I did get a couple of hits. Not many, but a few.
A little tardy on that one was Matt Harvey. I was just reading some stuff on Harvey. His dad, Ed, did the right thing. Did not allow Matt to throw a breaking ball for a long time. Dad was a coach. That's in the dirt. Didn't let him throw a curveball till he was 13, which I still think is too young. And you're a curveball pitcher. What are your thoughts?
I feel the same way now. I mean, I started throwing one when I was 11. That wasn't good, but I promised my dad at the time that I wouldn't try to throw the breaking ball, that I would just let it roll off. A gradual rolling curveball, and it worked.
And that pitch worked. He gone, and we're in to the sixth.
A pitching matchup for the ages, as it's turned out. Five innings, three hits for the Mets, one for our Sox, no runs, only one walk combined. That Jose Quintana and each. Hurler has fanned six. So as the game rolls along, there's a lot of goose eggs up on the board. Let's see who gives way first. And judging by numbers, and again, those are numbers from this year, Harvey does get worse as he goes through the bottom part of the order for the second time, and certainly the first time through the order, the third time he faces it.
First ball, fastball, but you can understand why he didn't go after that one. Split the outside corner. Rollins went out to left field his first trip. All right, that's out number one. And I mentioned earlier, I did not see that play of Syndergaard throwing at Chase Utley, and Mike Leary all of a sudden says, poof, here it is.
And gives him the heave-ho as Terry Collins comes out. And he gets rung up.
Well, it looks like Syndergaard's one of those guys that, you know, you and I grew up in a culture of, to coin a phrase from Clint, a man's got to know his limitations. And a man's got to do what a man's got to do. And if he felt like he should throw at him, he did.
Well, there was a very hard slide at second base. Ruben Tejada was the guy who broke his leg. Chase Utley was the guy who slid. And that was a little carryover.
Which is all right if that's the way you feel.
Yeah,
that was one of the codes, or one issue in the code in those days. If you feel like you got to do it, do it.
And the one drawback as far as our ball club is concerned is that Syndergaard is available and said that he wouldn't mind throwing out of the bullpen for tomorrow night's game. So this is a full-time starter that will be available for Terry Collins tomorrow out of the pen. So he normally can get it up there in the high 90s consistently. I'm sure he's going to probably be able to reach triple digits out of that pen if he does come out tomorrow night.
Well, he's 6'6", 245. He's a big man.
He is a big man with a great arm.
Here's the 1-2.
Like Noah Syndergaard this year, 5-2 with an ERA of 1.87 in his 10 starts. One interrupted by the ejection. Other than that, not too many people hit him. 9 walks, 79 strikeouts. Yikes.
Well, as you do, and I did, know a lot of pitchers that when Chase Utley came to the plate, he was going to get drilled.
Yep.
Or thrown at, trying to drill. Alex just got a piece of it. So count hangs at 3-2. Alex struck out, called out. On a fastball his first trip.
Well, he's hoping to get some sort of breaking ball or maybe an errant form of a changeup, because for a dead pull hitter, it's pretty easy to hit it out in right field, assuming you can pull the ball.
It's not too bad with 358 out there in left field either.
No. It's very good if you can pull it in this park.
Ball hit hard.
As part of Sox Serve Week, the White Sox Wives and White Sox Volunteer Corps are celebrating Southpaw's birthday. Bring a new unwrapped toy on Sunday, June 12th, to drop off at locations at U.S. Cellular Field. That's any gate. You can also donate, if you'd like, $10 cash, because they will be accepted gladly.
Let's get back to that. Ed Harvey not allowing him, Matt's son Matt, to throw a curveball till he was 13. And that's fair. We'll talk about that when we return, because we didn't score. And we'll go to the bottom of the sixth. Still no score. Some kind of nice pitching matchup here this afternoon. But getting back to, I want to let the parents out there understand one thing. Steve Stone was a bit of an unusual. He's not a big guy. He's a small guy, as a matter of fact. But he was a very, very hard thrower. And then he hurt his arm, and he became a breaking ball pitcher. So you speak from experience. You've been on both sides of that equation. And tell some of those parents about allowing the children to throw sliders and breaking balls.
I think the biggest detriment of that is 11, 12, 13, even maybe sometimes 14. You just haven't developed. You haven't even come close to developing a muscular structure, a bone structure, as you're going to have when you get a bit older. And so you can do yourself some injuries that might not show up, some weakness that might not show up until a little bit later. And that's why we're seeing a lot of guys now coming and going through two Tommy John surgeries because of strain on the elbow. And so I think it's a really good idea. And listening to a lot of good pitching coaches and managers talk, if you can throw a two and a four seam fastball, locate them, and then use a straight change as your second pitch, that's not going to strain your arm at all. But when you factor in then, especially a hard slider, I think is tougher than a curveball on your arm, but you know, let him ease those in gradually as he matures and he gets a little bit bigger, a little bit stronger. And I think for the long run, it's going to be a whole lot better, even if he's not as effective as he would be earlier in his career.
Well, last week I was watching my grandsons play a couple of games. We were in Warsaw in a tournament. And another thing that sort of disturbed me to a degree, they had these youngsters and they were pitching from 60 feet 6 inches. They were playing on regulation field and they're young.
How old were they? I mean, what was the
12,
age group of the league?
12 and 13. And they're just not developed to be throwing that hard. And there was one kid out there who was throwing really, I mean, hard. And here he's 13 years old. He's throwing, and he's going to go 5 or 6 innings. He's walking guys. He's going 2-2, 3-2 on a lot of guys. He's airing it out every pitch. He didn't throw any breaking balls. But still, that is another thing. He's just not developed. Those little guys are, there he go, 7. And as a matter of fact, I didn't see one of our pitchers in those two games throw one breaking ball. Not one. So that's good coaching there.
Well, that and the fact that, and a lot of guys will tell you that when they talk about showcase performances, they're talking about scouts come out, they take a look at a guy. I'm not talking about 12 and 13 year olds. I'm talking about older, maybe second year of high school, first year of college, whatever. They're throwing four scouts. And they are vitally concerned about the radar gun, throwing absolutely as hard as they can. And that's not great because you lose a sense of pitching.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. If I had anything to do with the ball club, if I owned a ball, I would not allow radar guns in spring training for my young pitchers. That is just an accident waiting to happen.
I think a lot of major league pitchers like to turn around. I know Ventura from Kansas City likes to turn around and look at that radar gun.
Cabrera can't get it. He has gone out fairly deep to right center and struck out. Keep those radar guns away from young pitchers, because Steve just said they're going to see it, and all of a sudden now they're going to get amped up. That juice is going to flow. Adrenaline now. Here they comes. Everything they got. How do you feel about long toss?
I think long toss is terrific.
Yeah, Drysdale did too. I thought that was one of the secrets to being a
long toss is one of the best things a pitcher can do because it becomes a natural motion. You're throwing as over the top as you're going to get, and it does elongate the muscles.
There's a base hit. He's going to give it a go. Here's the throw. He gone. Another beautiful throw. I'll tell you what, our outfield play this year, for the most part, has been, we had a few glitches and bumps in that last homestand, but outside of that, it's been fantastic.
Every game, it amazes me how people are still running on Melky. I mean, Melky has been this accurate for a long time, and the ball is just waiting for Asdrubal Cabrera to arrive. I mean, if he's at first base with one out, at least you got something going. knowing that you got Cespedes coming up, and he's the guy that's killed Quintana. Anyway, Melky guns him down. I think that's the third he's thrown out this year.
Well, evidently they weren't watching last year either.
Now, Melky might not be the fastest guy around in left field, but if he gets his hands on it, he's going to put the throw right on the money.
So here's the one man you don't want to make a mistake on. He's 1-for-2, a bullet into left field for a base hit. He is now 10-for-17 against Quintana. You know, those 10 hits, 6 of them stayed in the park. What? 2-1.
It's not going to work, but with the shift on, with Laurie playing on the grass on the third base side of second, they're inviting Cespedes to try to punch it through the right side.
Hoping he will try. That's high and deep. But back on the track, right in front of the horizon. Makes the catch that'll retire the side. And on this Memorial Day, USAA honors our fallen soldiers. Top of the order, Eaton, Abreu, and Cabrera to face Matt Harvey.
Now we'll see if third time through is the charm, because he was awfully tough twice through the lineup.
Adam has gone out to center and struck out. No runs, one hit, no errors for us, no runs, four hits, no errors for them.
That was a very good breaking ball. He's only thrown 72 pitches.
There's a shot. This goes foul. Couldn't get it down quick enough. Full count. Harvey giving one hit, no walk, six strikeouts.
Tried to get a little something extra on that one. Got it up there at 97, right in on Eden's hands, who was able to fight it off and keep the at bat alive.
And another fastball, 96 this time.
This year, Matt Harvey has not been able to make it past six innings. There you look at the numbers. 96 miles an hour on the fastball. Change up 88.
And there is the leadoff man, the first walk issued by Harvey. Sox fans, show your team pride with White Sox checking and an official White Sox MasterCard debit card. That's only available at your local Wintrust Community Bank. So go to Wintrust.com/Sox to learn more. Member FDIC.
So let's see if this elevation to the two spot helps Abreu the third time through.
Man, Harvey. Only been out of the stretch one time. Four, and there's a base hit. First two men aboard.
There's Terry Collins, and a lot of people who've known Terry for a long time say that he has gone through quite a metamorphosis as a skipper. Dan Worthen comes out. He wants to have a word with Harvey. And the metamorphosis for Terry Collins, early in his career, he was very fiery, very feisty. And it certainly was shown to his ball club. It was almost on a daily basis. That's how he went about things. But coming here to New York, he's changed. He has mellowed out somewhat, understanding probably better than ever that it's the relationship with the players that is really going to make the biggest difference. So he's a lot calmer than he was. That probably has something to do with taking his team to the World Series. But he's been around a while, so the bullpen up and going, and a chance to break through here in the seventh.
Here's Melky, a strikeout and a ground out to second. Cabrera trying to sneak in behind Adam. Toughest base running play for a base runner is this situation, man on first and second, bunt situation. And don't get picked off.
It's easy to do with a decent secondary lead trying to beat a play at third base.
Well, if you're the runner, you got to make your teammate do his job with the bat and get the bunt down. But you cannot get picked off under any circumstances.
And we'll have to see how they choose to defend it. They can defend it with Harvey breaking straight in, or they can defend it with Kelly staying back and Harvey breaking toward the third base line.
That's a good one. Good bunt by Melky. So Ducks on the punt, one out. And here comes Frazier.
Melky with his second sacrifice of the year. Now you'd have to think that Frazier is going to hit with the luxury of having the infield in. But Terry Collins trying to stay out of a two-run situation has got him back in the middle infield. Somewhat surprising in the seventh inning.
Here's where a hitter sometimes can do himself a disservice. And say, just here's an example, getting in there. You got first base open. You got a man tied for major league leading home runs. And you can't say to yourself, well, they're not going to give me anything good to hit. You cannot do that. And there he took one right down the gut. So hopefully, if that thought was in there, it's gone. That's inside. Boy, I like to have a dozen golf balls every time I've done that and outdone myself. High pop up right side. This is not going to get it done. Two down. Throw us up to J.B. Shuck. J.B. had our first hit. Back in the fifth, a line shot into right field for a single.
Rivera looking over in the dugout to see with a righty-righty matchup next what he wants to do with him. But last time up, Brett Laurie hit a rocket speared by Flores at first base. So they're going to pitch to Shuck at least for the moment.
You got Ty Kelly even with the bag off the line at third. So now he's going to back up just a step or so and then come in with the pitch.
Harvey's got four wild pitches this year, tying him for the team lead in that department.
Ball hit hard. Meanwhile, they're going to get out. Seventh inning stretch. Still no score.
Ladies and gentlemen, the New York Mets join Major League Baseball in support of the National Moment of Remembrance and pause this Memorial Day to remember the brave men and women who made the ultimate sacrifice in service of our country. Please join us now in this moment of silence as a collective, unified expression of gratitude to the heroes who lost their lives while protecting the freedoms we enjoy today. Thank you. Please remain standing for the singing of God Bless America as we welcome Amanda Downey, Amanda Altimore, Priscilla Flowers, Bronson Murphy, and Chris Brassfield of the USO Show Troop.
From the mountains
Ladies and gentlemen, the USO show troop.
Schedule brought to you by Travel Wisconsin. Plan your fun today at travelwisconsin.com, and we roll right along on the road. Two more against these same Mets, and then a day off and on to Detroit. And we finish up what has turned into a nine-game road trip.
There, half of the seventh inning, it'll be Walker, Flores, and Diaza. Neal has struck out and walked. Takes down low.
Pitch number 89 on the way. And it's the middle part of the order due up.
That's high and deep in the left center field. And it's 1-0.
So the second home run Jose Quintana has thrown this year. The 12th home run hit by Walker, and he's now driven in 23. And that breaks up a scoreless ball game. A Ford home run replay. We told you about Walker swinging the bat much better from the right side these days than he ever had. That's his fifth home run. That's in just 40 at bats right handed.
That's something. Just the second home run given up. And now 71 innings.
Pretty amazing run for Quintana, but he finds himself trailing. And the one bit of decent news is that Familia, the closer of the Mets, has really scuffled the last few times out. He's got 16 saves. He had his problems in the ball game yesterday, coming into a tie game, a no save situation. He gave up a couple of runs, and the Dodgers beat the Mets.
Two and one to count. Flores struck out and hit into a 5-4-3 double play, but his big contribution to this ball game was a brilliant play off the bat of Brett Laurie, turning it into a double play. Or else we would have had men at second and third and only one out.
And there is the bullpen, and that looks like Addison Reed. That's because it is Addison Reed, and he's the only guy in that bullpen that has a save other than Familia.
Well, there's a bullet.
There's a couple of ballparks where if the ball goes down the third baseline, the shortstop becomes involved. One of them is Fenway Park, and apparently here's another one, because this ball hits the tarp, and instead of rolling down the left field line, it kicks back out, and Jimmy Rollins has to go get it. So it deflects off the glove, hits the tarp, bounces straight across, and no chance for Melky. So Jimmy Rollins thought he might have had a shot. He's played at this park a long time while a member of the Phillies.
Here's Diaza. Corners in close. Outfield slightly to the left. If you're just tuning in, 1-6-0 for their guys, 0-2-0 for our guys.
Diaza does not have a sacrifice.
Takes a strike. We get a break there. It's 1-1.
There you look at some pretty good numbers.
He still doesn't have a sacrifice.
Now, if you take a guy that is not used to bunting, and Diaza is not, he's used to bunting for hits, not sacrificing. And when that happens, more times than not, he's going to pop it up. That's exactly what happened there.
Well, I think what Terry Collins had in mind with the numbers on the lower part of this order was a sacrifice bunt, get him over the third, and then sacrifice squeeze him in. Rivera had a shattered broken bat soft single in the left field. Two.
Whether he goes any more or not, Matt Harvey has given Terry Collins and the Mets exactly what they needed, because he was scuffling with an ERA up over six. They wanted him to go deep in the game. They had a game last night against the Dodgers. He wanted to stay out of the pen as long as possible. He was able to do that.
Back.
Matt Albers throwing in the Sox pen. Outfield straight away, not overly deep. Not going to be easy for Flores to score on a base hit.
Oh, Another foul, though. Well, the Mets have seen a couple good left-handers the last two games.
Indeed, Clayton Kershaw, who did not get a decision in that ball game, he faced him last night.
Well, he went 7 2/3, 4 hits, 2 runs, no walks, 10 strikeouts.
Pretty amazing performance. When you look at what he's done, walks to strikeouts this year, it's like 10-1, strikeouts over walks.
And he just got a piece of that one.
So Zach Duke has joined Matt Albers in the pen. Got some left-handed thunder on their bench for pinch hitting. Granderson given the day off. He's hit 9 home runs. Michael Conforto, he's hit 8 home runs, and neither of them started. So you bring in a righty, you're going to probably be looking at one of those guys.
So Rivera has worked a full count.
Robin taking a look over at lineup card to see who Terry Collins has at his disposal. And Matt Harvey has to be ecstatic with what he did here today.
Strong at bat right there for a light hitting catcher.
Here comes Don Cooper.
Second walk issued back in town.
Go over the game plan they had against Kelly. There you look at the lineups. Who's available? You see the two in red, Granderson and Conforto for the Mets.
So 2 on, 1 out, 1 in. They lead it 1-0. Come out on deck. Maybe a decoy for Terry Collins. Outfield spread out slightly to the right. Bit of a gap out there in left center. Kelly had his first major league hit in the fifth inning. He's 1-for-2. Striking out. Two and one.
The Mets' two most frequent pinch hitters are in the starting lineup, Lagares and Diaz.
So Kelly, ahead in the count. Pops it up into short center field. Two down.
Family Sundays presented by Coca-Cola at U.S. Cellular Field feature tickets as low as $5 in the upper level and $15 in the lower level and special kids-focused activities throughout the ballpark. Plus, parking is available for only $10. Visit whitesox.com/Sundays to purchase your tickets today.
So here's Campbell. Hitting in 161, a homer, he's driven in five.
As a pinch hitter, 1-for-6.
He gets a bit of a break right there, and they count nothing in one. And that's yanked foul. So the Sox trying to rebound from that sweep. Kauffman Stadium against Kansas City. That Kansas City club, too much TWTW. The will to win. They got a whole bunch of it.
Pitch number 113 on the way, and this inning has been laborious. Jose Quintana. 0-2 fastball spun him out of there.
About a 53-footer.
Good stop by Avila as that one bounds well in front of the plate. No advancement. So the at-bat continues for Eric Campbell, who played collegiately at Boston College.
Twos up there, two balls, two strikes, two out, two on.
Now the disadvantage is runners will be going, taking a force out of the equation. And making it a whole lot easier for Flores to score if one sneaks through.
Pops him up. Watch out now. Jimmy taking charge, makes the call, has the ball, and that'll retire the side. But the home run by Neil Walker will go to the eighth. We lead it. Check it. We trail it. 1-0. town and on Sportsnet Central. Get a recap of tonight's game plus highlights from around the leagues. So don't miss Sportsnet Central tonight at 6:30 on CSN's Crawler.
Anderson Reed comes into the ball game, and you're very familiar with him. The only thing the Sox hope is that he falls in love with that slider, which he does on occasion. He's been awfully good this year, on for the 25th time. ERA 2.08. 28 strikeouts and 21 and two-thirds, and Harvey will depart after a strong seven, giving up just two hits, no runs, and one walk.
And throwing 100% first ball fastball.
Pretty amazing.
So here's Brett Laurie. He got a good pitch for him to hit and pops it up. Brett now 0 for 3. Addison picked up 40 saves for us back in 2013. 29 and 2012. Here's Jimmy. He's going out to left and he's grounded to second. Got a shift on for him. Addison's been around for a while and he's still just 27 years old.
Had some great moments out of the bullpen for the Sox.
Two down.
Rollins could not lay off of the high heat.
So here's Alex Avila 0 for 2, a strikeout and a ground out, a hard ground out. Garcia has come out to hit for Quintana. If Alex can get on and the count 0-1. First of a three-game set. And fourth of what's going to be a nine-game road trip. Tomorrow night, Latos against Steven Matz, left-hander. We'll have the game for you right here on Comcast Sportsnet. And on Wednesday afternoon, Miguel Gonzalez against Jacob DeGrom. And that game will be over WGN.
Steven Matz, just one in a long line of quality pitchers to come out of this system. He's 7-1, his ERA 2.36. 50 strikeouts, 9 walks in 49 and two-thirds innings.
Well, the Mets, without question, over the years have developed more good young pitchers than any other club in baseball.
They have that. Then they try to fill in the outfield positions with some thumpers from other organizations. Granderson being one of them. Cespedes, another one of those guys. However, they did develop Conforto, and he's got a chance to be 100 RBI guy every year with 20 some homers.
2-2. $38,339 on this Memorial Day as he gets him looking for a 1-2-3 inning, a couple strikeouts, and we'll go to the bottom of the eighth trailing 1-0.
Offense by Jose Quintana. He's going to leave trailing 1-0 in favor of Matt Albert.
Well, the man who's leading the league in ERA, Jose Quintana, is going to see his ERA go down, and yet he's liable to pick up a loss.
Well, he's hoping to pick up what has been known as a Quintana, which is a no decision, but to do that, Sox are going to have to score, and Albert's going to have to hold the top of the order right here.
So Quintana's ERA came in at 2.22, is now 2.13. Here's Lagares.
He had a pretty decent idea, however. He popped it up, fouled it back. Albers is on for the 24th time. He's seen his ERA swell to 4.29.
One pitch. The ball hit hard. We got a man there. It's a hang with him. The one Lagares.
Join the WhiteSox.com blacklist and enter for a chance to win 16 great prizes in 16 weeks, along with monthly prizes, including game tickets, as well as amazing grand prize at the end of the season. Wow, that's a long sentence. Visit WhiteSox.com/Sox16 for complete details.
Asdrubal Cabrera, 1-for-3. Had a single in the left field. Tried to stretch it into a double as he pokes that one out there right off the end of the bat. And here's the sixth inning.
He's out dead to rights on a perfect throw.
Cespedes. 1-for-3. Takes first pitch strike.
Last time up to end the sixth inning, he hit one way back in left center field. Did, however, stay in the park, caught on the warning track. There was a time when you had to be careful with Asdrubal Cabrera. This time for him, not so much. One attempted steal. He was caught stealing. The Mets, who had the lowest stolen bases in the major leagues last year, only have 10 this year.
He just missed that one. He just missed that one. Two down. And that'll bring up Neil Walker. Led off last inning with his 12th home run. And here comes Robin. And I think Zach Duke's going to be coming on. All right, so Albert departs, and we'll be back.
service experts call to the pen, and that is Zach Duke. Duke on for the 28th time. He's had three save opportunities, has not been successful. No record. 3.63 ERA, and he's going to look in at Walker. The difference in this game, hitting from the right side. And as you can see, Neil Walker, although the numbers are skewed, having him a better hitter from the right side this year, he normally is much more effective left-handed.
So one on, two out. For our guys in the top of the ninth, probably be Avi hitting for the pitcher spot. And back to the top of the order with Eaton, Abreu, and Cabrera. That'll retire the side. A rocket off the bat of Neil Walker. We're into the ninth. We need one to tie.
It's Miller time, brought to you by Miller Lite, and here's our Miller moment, and it can only be the one moment of the ball game. Neil Walker takes one out of the ballpark, and that is the sum total of all the scoring. So Walker, our Miller moment, and we've got a new pitcher coming in the ball game. It's Dries Familia. 16 of 16 in save opportunities, was hit around last night in a non-save situation. And there you see the numbers. He's been terribly effective. Hopefully a little carryover from last night.
So here's the honor. Pinch hitting. Adam Eaton on deck. Jose Abreu in the hole. 1-0 bad guys.
He was nicknamed Hombre Sucio by Michael Kadir. That means Mr. Nasty. And when he's right, his stuff can be overwhelming. They're the boys looking for some offense.
Two and two. Full count. Boy, he is just flying open.
Let's hope those mechanics hold up as Rivera goes out there, tells him what he sees. Last year, his ERA was under 2, 43 saves. MLB.tv Premium, the number one live streaming sports service, delivers everything you've come to expect and more. Watch every out-of-market game live on HD and over 400 supported devices. Includes a free subscription to At-Bat Premium, the number one app for live baseball. So blackout and other restrictions apply. Visit MLB.tv for details.
Here's Adam. He's 0 for 2 with a walk. He walked the lead off the seventh, if you're just tuning in. And we had a base hit by Abreu. Had the first two guys on. Nobody out. Sacrifice bunt by Cabrera. And Frazier popped up and J.B. Shutt grounded out. Count evens at one. It's Adam. Abreu on deck.
You'd love to get Adam on. Familia is not quick to home plate. Looks like he is taking his time somewhat. Now, whether he quickens it up with a slide step or not, we'll have to see. But Rivera putting down a fastball and saying, hit my glove.
Two down. Here's Abreu. Has one of the two hits. Shuck has the first one in the fifth. Abreu, as I mentioned, in the seventh. Right there. Might be the best one he gets in this whole sequence. And once again, a very happy Memorial Day to each and all. And that's going to stay foul. Down to our last bullet, 0-2. Two out. First of three. And fourth of nine on this road trip. We'll have two more here and then finish it off with three in Detroit. Power against power. We're setting up that way outside the plate.
Well, he went to the slider, but he didn't want it anywhere near as he was setting up in the left-handed batter's box. Take a look where Rivera sets up. Last thing he wants him to do is hang a slider. Well, let's see if he goes and gets him with an inside fastball.
Bring it, he said. This ball game is over.
Not the best call I've seen, but it ends the ball game. No chance that he swung it.
Well, we beat ourselves in this one. Yep. In fact, it wasn't the umpire that beat us in this.
Nope.
In this game. You had a guy out there, Steve, going first ball, fastball, 100% of the time.
And this was the best outing by far for Harvey, a big relief for the Mets. Unfortunately, no offense, and Jose Quintana, as has been his tendency, not a whole lot of luck as his record falls to 5-5.
Well, for the second time this season, we are just the second time, I should say, we're shut out so far. Steve Stone, for our Hall of Fame director, Jim Mangio, our future Hall of Fame producer, Mike Leary, also Dave Ross, and Joe Group, the mayor, to me, Joe Group, also our technical manager, Mark Harper, the executive producer, Jim Corno Jr., also for Emmy Award-winning Jimmy Dos Santos, Mike Masseri, Joel Salco, Steve Mendel, Ryan Robbins. This is a Hawk. So long, everybody. Coming up next, Subaru Postgame Live with Chuck and Bill. You've been watching White Sox baseball on Comcast SportsNet.